What am I? I'm from another planet here because cell biology, I did a little things there, but not too many. So since I'm from another planet, I'll start my lecture by something very wide, the universe. So let's look at the chemistry of the universe. The physics of the universe is very complicated, but the chemistry is very simple. The most abundant element is hydrogen. Oxygen is forming by abrupt cosmic event like supernova. But if you give it enough time, of course, this reducing agent will reduce the oxygen to form water. Therefore, hydrogen is very abundant in the universe, and water is also quite abundant. But oxygen is extremely rare. Now, if we look of part of this universe on our planet from satellite, this is artificial colors, but they represent what we see. We see essentially oxygenic photosynthesis, an oxygenic world. And you see in the oceans certain photosynthetic organisms called mainly cyanobacteria, and in the terrestrial part, you see the green part that is plants and other things that do photosynthetic, oxygenic photosynthesis. And you see that big parts of the world are arid, and I will come to this, and Israel is also not very green, only the Nilus Delta is a little bit green. That's it. So how we came to have such unique thing essentially in the universe? And I would like to claim that the likelihood to find such situation in our galaxy, in the Milky Way, is extremely slim. Because Earth has certain properties that allowed the formation of oxygen by oxygenic photosynthesis, and this process is obviously the most important thing in the world. So without it, we wouldn't have cancer problem, probably. So, however, when we follow by many measures the amount of oxygen on Earth, so oxygenic photosynthesis started 3.5 billion years ago, but for over 1 billion years, the atmosphere was completely anaerobic. So the question, what happened with all the oxygen that was produced there, and what happened on Earth in this period of anaerobiosity? So essentially, most of the electron produced by oxygenic photosynthesis went to something else than CO2, essentially to hydrogen, to protons. And essentially, this process of hydrogen production from water that we would like to reproduce it now for energy production was one of the main reactions at that time. Now, what happened with all of this hydrogen? It appeared that the size of Earth is just about that allow escape of hydrogen, but no other element. Would it not be that way? Hydrogen will be accumulated. A few thunders will ignite the entire world every year, and evolution wouldn't be able to happen. So one of the ingredients of Earth that is really unique is that we had about 4.5 billion years of evolution to be continuous and not interrupted totally by cosmic events. Of course, cosmic events did a lot of things on Earth, including the life on Earth, but they never killed all the organisms on Earth. So then, after it happened, essentially, what happened with the oxygen at that time? Why it didn't accumulate in the atmosphere? All of this oxygen essentially was consumed by iron that was in reduced form. Sedimented in the oceans, and now we dig them, the iron, to make steel out of it. So it was very important in the event, but then the iron was exhausted and oxygen start accumulating on Earth. And you see that it was not smooth curve to what we have today. There were changes in the oxygen concentration on Earth in different period of time. And this one is probably the Jurassic time. It had about 30% oxygen in the atmosphere. One of the ways that we know that this amount of oxygen was here was because insects with the wings of about 3 meters were able to fly on in the atmosphere. And the respiration system cannot hold today with 20% more than half a meter long or something like this. But there are many other evidences for this. So essentially what I want to point out that then something happened and it went down. But I don't want to coin out the events, what happened here. But you have to realize that about 10% oxygen drop on Earth had to count something, okay? So would it come from respiration that consumed the oxygen? Then we had to accumulate about 10% CO2 in the atmosphere. It never happened in the atmosphere. So something else happened. And essentially, the accumulation of bio-organic material on Earth with all the effects that I told you, this is the story of electron transport, sunlight capturing, and biological material accumulation and atmosphere formation and abrupt change in the neural crest on the crest of Earth. Okay. So now, what is oxygenic photosynthesis? This is an old process that evolved 3.5 billion years ago, which is amazing. And already there, it was composed of 4 very big membrane complexes to carry oxygenic photosynthesis. And essentially, in the 3.5 billion years ever since, things were added to each one of the complexes, but the basic parts of the membrane complexes was there 3.5 billion years ago. And essentially, what represent now this old oxygenic photosynthesis is the photosynthesis carried out by cyanobacteria. They change very little from that time. And in higher plant, it is another matter. So I changed many subjects in my career. And for the 60th birthday, I gave myself a present here in Tel Aviv. I decided to become a structural biologist and to find the structure of plant photosystem bran, arguably one of the most complicated membrane complexes in nature, if not the most complicated one. I had no education in structural biology, nothing, but I decided to do it. At that time, it was no single report on plant membrane protein that was solved by X-ray crystallography, not single transmembrane ELISA at that time. And I knew that here we have many, many of them and many, many prosthetic groups. So I took one student. First of all, what gave me the confidence that indeed I can do it? It was only biochemistry, and it was mentioned by many people here, bigger than me. So only biochemistry. In 73, when I was beginner as an assistant professor in the Technion, I was able to isolate photosystem 1 in pure form. And essentially, I stress it, that at that time, people, the kings in the field, believe that photosystem 1 is composed of a trimer of proteins right here in this gel. Okay? So I came to the conclusion that this is the pure photosystem 1 at that time already. I had to fight on this for about 5 years until it was accepted. But now, of course, I have evidence of structure, so nobody can argue about it. So how to go from here to here? It is very simple. You start with the most pure membranes you can. So if you start with junk membranes, you will end up with something that is like this. How you start with pure membranes? You cut each leaf of this pea, and you don't harvest the entire crop and try to make membranes. We tried it, no crystallization whatsoever, never. So you start with chopping the leaves, then you isolate chloroplasts, what you have here, and in the chloroplast membrane, in the thylakoid membrane, already on SDS, we see a subunit of each one of the 4 membrane complexes. We already see them, okay? And this is the starting material for the purification. And then we got usual things, which I won't elaborate on this, to come to this stage. Now, I started it, and Adam Ben-Shem joined my laboratory. Adam Ben-Shem is a genius student, very, very interesting person. He's genius in literature, music, art, whatever you want, he knows. And he decided to solve the structure of plant photosystem 1 for his PhD. I warned him that it is absolutely unlikely we should go somewhere else, but he decided to stay. And we got the first crystal after about 3 months of work, big crystal, diffracted to 20 angstrom. So this is structural biology for you. 4 years later, he is half a year before finishing his PhD. He has no single experiment to present. Nothing. So I told him, look, I'm doing molecular biology. Let's clone something, do this. In half a year, you get PhD, no problem. He said, no. If I cannot solve plant photosystem 1, it means that I don't deserve to be a PhD. And he did it. So he did it with the help of a very good crystallographer, Felix Frolov. And this is Adam Ben-Shem. Today he is much more bold than him. Okay. So he solved it to this, the diffraction to this point, and I won't go to the diffractions. Then we keep doing it, okay? And Alexei Mons came to this point, 3.4 angstrom resolution. And Yuval Mazor came now to here, now. Just about to here, and you will see it soon. Now, these two people became very famous because he also solved the eukaryotic ribosome for the first time, and I know that his contribution was major in this. And Alexei Mons, with Venki Ramakrishnan, published 3 papers in Science for the mitochondrial ribosome, human, yeast, and so on. For Yuval to be as famous as them, he has to solve ribosome. but maybe nothing left. However, Alexei solved it by the cryo-EM. And Venki, I highly recommended him to Venki and John Walker. And in the last, after about 4 years that he was in his laboratory, I used to hide that they will not see me because they didn't publish one thing. So one day we came to the requiem of ID-14 in ESRF, that old station that Venki and me used heavily to give lecture. I was hiding, and then Venki spotted me, and he said, "The two mentors, we have to have picture together." So I said, what happened? He said, "This guy came to my office one Saturday, and he showed me tracing of amino acids in ribosome in a subunit that was not recognized by the biochemists." As simple as that. And this was amazing. And Alexei is smart and everything, but he also, his social life is so likable and so on and so forth that everybody helped him in this, in MRC, and he was able to solve the ribosomes. Yuval came with no knowledge in structural biology, and today he's a fantastic structural biologist. Everybody that wants to solve something should consult Yuval. So, I told you that Yuval is somewhere here. So, let's look at what was the structure of ADAM that was published as an article in Nature in 2003. So essentially, this is not a real structure, this is a model. But the model is very important for understanding many things. First of all, what we saw is that we have a center that is highly homologous to the cyanobacteria, and the structure of this part was published 2 years before as an article in Nature also from the German group. And there were a lot of homologies between them. So it was, we couldn't make molecular replacement, we solved it from scratch, from mercury labeling. So we solved it, and it was highly homologous to the cyanobacterial. But there were very important additions. One addition is right here, it's subunit H, and one of them is subunit G right here. So this one, designed by Nature as such that it will prevent trimerization of the photosystem 1. And all the cyanobacterial photosystem 1s are mainly trimers. A little bit monomers, mainly trimers. So why you prevent trimerization? To have more surfaces for a lot of control reaction for interaction. And this is the essence of advancement in evolution. The other thing, you are going to go from the ocean to land. You need to capture the light in very efficient way. And then about when the eukaryotic organisms start forming, 4 different light harvesting chlorophyll protein complexes were added to the reaction center. Even though we cannot trace the amino acids right here, Adam was able to assign each one of them to different gene product, and he was right. And this is once again due to enormous amount of biochemical work that was done, not in our laboratory, but in several laboratories in Europe. In United States at that time, they didn't finance photosynthetic work, so we didn't benefit by this. So, so he was able to assign it. So now I'm going to show you the end of this story, but before that, how to achieve it. So as some of you know, that it is not enough to get very good diffraction. You have to phase the crystal, essentially the data. You have to phase it. And the better you phase it, the better electron density you get.
What do you mean by phasing?
Phasing, and I will not start to explain it. Phasing is like taking a picture from you, unfocused, okay? If I will put it in focus, it was phased well, okay? So your face will be distorted in unfocus. So I won't go to the technique, And essentially, we want to phase it by three iron clusters right here. And we took data in SLS in Bessie, Germany, complete data with the iron edge that is 1.74 angstrom. And much to our surprise, we got over 40 anomalous signals in the complex. And this was really something that we contributed even to structural biology. And what are these anomalous signals? All of them are sulfates and phosphates. So people that understand it, they know that now we can phase it extremely well. So good resolution, good phasing, gave us what you see here. Electron density that looks like this. So this is certain chlorophyll, 117A, in Adam's paper, okay? And this is the chlorophyll, the same chlorophyll today. And what we like, the structural biologists, this is essentially these holes. So if we do that, we can easily differentiate between chlorophyll A from chlorophyll A to chlorophyll B, because the only difference is this oxygen, and it is obvious that this oxygen is not present here, but it is present right here. Clear cut, no problem. Photosynthesis 1 contain four different carotenoids that has a lot of meaning in the protection against damage. And each one of them we can differentiate easily. They are completely different in the electron density and we can assign them. So this is not enough. We have lipids, structural lipids in photosystem 1. Phospholipid, glycolipid, and digalactosyl, and you see that there is no doubt about the electron densities of this. And to show off, the amino acid, the aromatic amino acid has holes, tryptophan 2, this one, and so on.
That the fatty acid chains are so well constrained.
Because they are structural, all the rest are not. Okay, of course. They are structural, this is from the middle of the... Okay, so... Huh? Okay. So, altogether, what we have is 16 subunits right here, 45 transmembrane helices, 229 prosthetic groups, which is no other complex in the world can show these kind of things. 140 chlorophyll A, 16 chlorophyll B, 27 beta-carotene, 7 luteins, 2 xanthophylls, zeaxanthin, and the different lipids that are present there, and the 2 quinones and 3 iron-sulfur clusters. And you see the intricate structure right here that it filled up the entire thing. The only hole that we have here of unstructured something, probably lipids that will not be structured at all. Thank you. So now we take out these 16 subunits and we look at the pigment, the important pigment that make the photochemistry. So you see chlorophyll A in green. All the carotenoids are in blue. In red are the quinones and the iron sulfur clusters right here in the middle. And I won't go into it because these voids are extremely important for the effect that this enormous complex operate with quantum yield of 1.0 or 99.8%. Quantum yield, not energy, okay? It loses energy, but quantum yield, 1.0. Every photon that hits everywhere here will travel probably through 150 of them, end up here, and one electron will jump. This is the photoelectric effect of Einstein in its best, not in single whatever. So, and you see the distribution of chlorophyll B.
Huh? No internal symmetry.
There is internal symmetry right here. Here, in the middle, only in the middle. There is internal symmetry, and it came from gene duplication. I will come to it in a minute.
Oh, so there's a diode across the...
Yeah.
I see the diode.
So these are the pigments, and you see that the distribution of chlorophyll B are different in the different light harvesting antenna, even though all of them evolve from a single light harvesting complex, primordial one. So in photosystem one, they already specialized even in this respect. And of course, the sequence couldn't reveal it at all because chlorophyll A and B, they have the same binding site, practically. So this is the complex. And the question, what is the mechanism of excitation transfer from here to the middle? Frankly, I don't know, after all the years. It is very difficult to find out something sound physically, that will give the answer. What we know, that if, for example, a photon hits here, it will come to here with 99.8% efficiency. Now, I evoked a proposition that involve quantum biology that is very controversial now, and I proposed that there are positive phonons provided by the skeleton of the amino acids in this complex. Now phonons, this is a quanta of sound that contain a lot of vibration considered to be destructive to excitation. And I think that nature invented here something that make it positive, and therefore it can maintain it from decay on the way. But I will not be able to prove it or even to discuss it because I'm not physicist.
Are there mutations that interfere with the electron transfer?
Almost nothing, because this is a robust system. You can remove by computation and whatever you want each one of these chlorophylls, and they will find the way to overcome the thing. But you cannot mutate right here in the middle, of course, where the business end of it. So, if you cannot solve the mechanism, talk about evolution. And this is legendary Ephraim Racker, my mentor, of course. So I will follow him willingly, and I will speak about evolution of the system. So one of the things that are interesting are these light harvesting chlorophyll proteins. And the question is, did they evolve from a single light harvesting, or from four of them, or two of them, and so on and so forth? And here, once again, the sequence will not give us answer at all for the evolution of them, because they are quite alike. But the lipids will. And these are all the lipids that we see in when we look at the membrane. And these are the two kinons. But it doesn't matter. So what happened is that LHCA1 and LHCA2 have the first and the third, they have phospholipid that is coordinated chlorophyll A, right here. The other one, 4 and 3 in this order, don't have this phospholipid at all, and essentially this arginine, lysine turn out instead of coordinating the phosphate right here. That's all. So this is evolution by structure. And sequence will not give you any answer for this. So now, taking all the evidences, structural evidences in my laboratory, in several other laboratories, and so on and so forth, we proposed a common evolution for all the reaction centers in bacteria, in alga, in higher plants. And it started by homodimeric reaction center that, by the way, we discovered together with Ginterauska by molecular biology, cloning, of course, and proving it in green bacteria. These are ancient bacteria that live usually in the depth of the Black Sea under anaerobic conditions. And they harvest a few photons to live during here. So they have homodimeric reaction center. Later on, in several other laboratories, it was discovered in other bacteria. So we have homodimeric structure. And we know this trick in genetics. It's no problem. Gene duplication makes it heterodimeric. It's amazing that it was maintained until this time. It's almost 4 billion years that this was maintained. So from here to photosystem one, this heterodimeric, more and more subunits and more chlorophylls were added to make photosystem one. In photosystem two, this is the oxygen evolving complex. Essentially, these two were split to two subunits, and they have homology to each other, right here. And these now four subunits form the heart of photosystem two, but photosystem two in higher plants is enormous, is even bigger than photosystem one. So it was very recently solved by Chinese group by electron microscopy, once again to 3.2 angstrom resolution. And it is amazing. Now, the controversial thing and the provocative thing that we suggest that the bacteria that contained very simple reaction center essentially evolved for more complicated reaction center by losing all the subunits and except for the two that are right here in the middle. For the evolution of photosystem one, we had many, many more data. And several years ago, I proposed this evolutionary scheme, homodimeric reaction center, heterodimeric plus something in the accepting site, adding more subunit. This is the donor site of photosystem one. We added this. And the common one between cyanobacteria and higher plant is right here. And essentially, what we proposed that in this junction, light harvesting chlorophyll proteins started to accumulate. And what I proposed it that PSAG served as the evolutionary template for having this light harvesting, and it started from here. And then you have all the four light harvesting chlorophyll proteins. So this was my suggestion. I was probably wrong. It starts from this end, from PSAK. Why I know it? Because I have a preliminary data from red alga, very old eukaryote, in which they have three light harvesting chlorophyll proteins right here, and this one is missing. So I can be wrong. That's easy. Okay, so now to complicate things more, we look at our planet once again. That's okay, I'm okay, no? Yes. We look at this planet. So what we see, oxygenic photosynthesis. What we will not see is in the ocean, the enormous amount of viruses, marine viruses. And essentially, it was estimated and published in Nature that the amount of genetic information in the ocean in marine viruses is tenfold more than all the organisms from bacteria to whales. So this is enormous place to dig. And bear in mind, when you dig to this ocean with the viruses, some of them may represent things that happened way before we can measure things that we see today. Because they maintain certain trends that we don't understand them. For example, some of these marine viruses, 50% of the reading frame is proteins that have no parallel in any living organism. So 50% of the reading frame, they did something once. Virus will not keep them for such a long time to this. So once again, I was lucky that Oded Beja, that is studying this in the Technion, came to my office a few years ago, and he told me, Nathan, we discovered photosystem 1 genes encoding photosystem 1 in marine virus. They were small pieces, and you have to prove that this is from the marine virus and not the cyanobacteria, because the homology is very big. To cut the story short, we collaborated with about 12 people writing this paper in Nature, and we found markers in the two sites of operon. And in contrast of cyanobacteria that have 7 operons that spread all over the genome to code for photosystem 1, this is a single operon in the virus. But there are 2 very important properties of this operon if it makes photosystem 1. One is that one operon that encodes PSAI and PSAL is missing. One of them, 2 subunits are missing. The other one was even more important. It is that J and F in all the bacteria are first F and then J. And here, there is a JF fusion protein. And one of the first sequences that he presented to me was this JF fusion protein. I told him it cannot be anything else but virus, because none of the creatures has this kind of thing. And essentially, what it is doing. So, first of all, we can do the... In cyanobacteria, we can easily delete I and L from the genome, that's homologous recombination. So we did it, and what you see here, that if you look at wild type, this is the trimer of photosystem 1, this is the monomer. All the reaction center of this delta L subunit photosystem 1 is monomer. But this was known, it essentially originated from my laboratory in Hoffman-LaRoche 30 years ago, that we knew about it. But this bacteria live very well with monomer without L. So the virus can encode photosystem 1 in this respect. And essentially, what we did, we looked at the Cynococcystis and we cloned it from Cynococcystis, solved the structure, and this is highly homologous to the thermophilic one, but I don't want to come into it. The thermophilic that was solved in Berlin has several differences that are critical for here. We are working on this, improving the structure. Then, this is the minus L, we solve it to 2.8 angstrom resolution, also a very interesting thing. I will have no time for this. But then we go to the JF. So we substituted the FJ operon by JF fusion protein that mimics the virus. This is not the viral itself. You see that it is still trimer in large. And essentially, the JF fusion protein is there. We proved by mass spectroscopy, but even better, we have the structure of the JF fusion protein. It's a trimer, and you see that the wild type in F has this blump. And this is the part of the binding site of the electron donor of photosystem 1. In the virus, it is absent. So immediately when I saw it already, when Beja showed me the JF fusion protein, I said, this is going to be promiscuous photosystem 1. The virus don't want to differentiate between different cytochromes and so on and so forth. Let's do it promiscuous. And indeed, the experiment the experiment showed that indeed the JF minus can accept electrons from Horsard cytochrome C even better than wild type, much better than wild type. So it is promiscuous. So essentially all of these are fine. We have a lot of fun with this and so on. But then after getting these results of the promiscuous virus, I couldn't sleep one night and I thought, let's think about the energy problem in the world. It's pompous a little bit, but let's think about it. So photosynthesis is very important. I told you all the fossil fuels come from photosynthesis and so on. Can we do something about it? And essentially, I came up with a scheme that may use photosynthesis to produce hydrogen from oxygen in an efficient and sustainable way. Now, all of you read newspapers and you see thousands of suggestions how to solve the energy problem in the world. Now, 99% of the suggestions are not sustainable. So I want to give you an example of what is sustainable energy production. And before that, we'll see what we need. So, something happened here. Doesn't matter. So in the projection that in 2050, we will have to have double the energy consumption of today, everybody quoted. It doesn't matter if this one. So now, essentially, I'm talking, but maybe that I'm talking for nothing because Trump will open up all the mines in Pennsylvania, and they can provide this and the mines in China and so on and so forth. But all of us appreciate that our grandchildren will suffer badly from this. So we must have energy that is carbon-free. We must have it. So for many years, I advocated atomic energy. But then I did a calculation of primary school. So if we want to supply all of this by atomic energy, this is the calculation, how much gigawatt we need. Atomic plant is about 1 gigawatt or 2 gigawatt. So if we want to supply the energy that way, we need to build atomic energy plan every day from now to 2050. Every day, not every week. So it is gone. So the only thing that was left is the sun that provides enormous amount of energy. And I want to give you example of what I mean by sustainable energy from the sun that will last for thousands of years. So for this, I take the Red Sea. The Red Sea is the only sea in the world that has no river to supply water to the Red Sea. All the water that evaporates from the Red Sea comes from the Indian Ocean. Okay? So what if we block it in Bab el-Mandab by a gate? It's only 23 kilometers, and it is not very deep there. So if we'll block it, according to the calculation of geologists and many people, the level of the Red Sea will drop by 2 meters every year. Okay? So we will wait, we will build this kind of thing, and we will wait for 4 years. It will be 8 meters deeper. From these 8 meters, we can have energy, electric energy, of close to 1 terawatt. 1 terawatt will supply energy to all the Middle East for many, many decades to come. However, there is one little problem that they fight with each other in each one of these things, and all of them fight with us, so it will be impossible to do it. But this is an example for sustainable energy. Not only this, the 1 terawatt can turn to 2 terawatts. Why? Because then you can collect in the Sahara and in this desert solar energy on panels of 1 more terawatt. And to provide the electricity at night, only at night, from the Red Sea. So it doubled the things that we can use. So we need global government, that Trump will not be the president. And essentially, I don't know if anybody. Huh? Yeah. Okay. So if not, why not do it photosynthetically? Okay, it's milder and we can do it. So there are thousands of suggestions how to harness the light energy by photosynthesis. And I have to admit that many of them, or almost all of them, are not sustainable. So what is the problem? If you produce hydrogen from oxygen, you produce from water, you produce oxygen at the same time. Now, there are tricks to overcome it, but they are not practical, and they are not, they will never be sustainable. So the question is how to do it in such way that specially, that in a space, oxygen will be produced in one part and hydrogen in the other part. They will be a mile apart, and one single cell will be do it that way and that way. Okay? So that night that I couldn't sleep, I came with an idea. Okay? So to help me with this idea, I got a fantastic PhD student. He's the perfect mix between German efficiency and Bolivian charm. So you can see in his face. What we want to do is to take the oxygenic photosynthesis and to block. It cannot be done because oxygen also inhibits these hydrogenases and they cannot live together. If we block photosystem 2 and we get the electrons from the biomass through the fact that this virus can accept electrons from the cytochrome C of mitochondria, okay, if we'll do it, we can produce the hydrogen from starch. And then this is temperature-sensitive mutant in photosystem 2. When we exhaust the starch, we go back to lower temperature, we do photosynthesis. So how we can do it mile apart? Here, once again, we use the property of hydrogen that is absolutely unique. We put it in plastic tube. And the only element that freely diffuses from plastic tube is hydrogen and none of the rest. So we collect outside of the plastic tube the hydrogen, and we don't have to purify it. It's nitrogen and hydrogen don't combust. So we need temperature-sensitive mutants. To my amazement, all my field never had them. So here are 4 different mutants, and we have now 20-something that he generated. That 1, 2, 3, 4. And you see that each one of them is different in properties. It means that the mutation is in different locations in each one of them. And indeed, it is in different locations. And when you reduce the temperature back, it goes back to here. However, the inhibition and the recovery are different. Here, after 7 hours, you have no oxygen evolution at all. Now, what happened to photosystem 2? It's very easy. I have antibodies in my refrigerator that I produced in the Technion 40-something years ago, and look at them. They are something. So wild type, you see at this subunit of photosystem 2, D1 and 43, doesn't matter which one you take, wild type, they stay all the 24 hours in the high elevated temperature. TSP1 goes down in about 12 hours, and the same with this subunit. You see the TSP2 maintain the entire photosystem 1, and it is absolutely inactive in oxygen evolution. This is a dream. Okay? Because all the subunits are there, and the recovery is much better. And this one goes very late. Okay? TSP4. So, we look at the hydrogen production at the non-permissive temperature, and this is a significant amount of hydrogen that is produced from the starch of this Chlamydomonas. But remember this number, something like 3. This doesn't matter. This is for photosynthetic people, 3. We have to reach about 150 to make it economical. Okay, a hint to you. So we do a primitive reactor in my laboratory, a few dollars, and that's all. This is plastic tube, okay, that come from aerobic condition to anaerobic condition. And we collect the hydrogen from here, and we measured that plastic tubes, the hydrogen diffuse freely, and we get equal amount of hydrogen that produced here versus if this will be anaerobic right here. No problem whatsoever. And none of the other element diffuse out of the tube. So, essentially, what we plan now and we built is much more sophisticated reactor. This is the elevated temperature. This is open space for room temperature and so on and so forth. And we can collect hydrogen here and emit, split the water for oxygen evolution a mile apart right here and to repeat it all the time. Now, I will be cheating if I will not tell you what kind of enormous problems we have to overcome. On this. So first of all, we use Chlamydomonas right here. Chlamydomonas will not stand more than 2 or 3 cycles under complete sterile conditions because it's prone to contamination. Most of the green bacteria that we can use, they are attacked by viruses. But here in Israel, we have something that is completely resilient and not attacked by viruses discovered by Mordechai Avron, by the late Mordechai Avron at Weizmann Institute. This is Donaliella. And Donaliella can live in the open, and it lives. People produce carotenoids from this in Eilat for years, and no problem whatsoever, no viruses, no nothing. And if we can transform all the properties of the Donaliella of the Chlamydomonas to Donaliella, then we solve the problem. But now, the yield is only about 5% of what we need. To increase the yield, we will need to engineer into Donaliella a much more fast elements of the metabolism that it has. Problem is, that there are many reports on transformation of Donaliella, but all of them false. So we have to find it. However, the CRISPR may come to our help. So now we try to use CRISPR with Donaliella to solve some of the problems. Okay? So this is just about what I wanted to tell you. And I want to tell you a few lessons from what you saw here. So if you have a scientific dream, go after it. Don't tell your boss that you do it. I'm now the boss, but I did it in the past. And I remember one night at 11 o'clock, I discovered something, and Rucker that was out of the blue, when Rucker came to the lab at 11 o'clock at night, I was jumping in the air. I told him what I did. He accepted it. He was extremely excited about it. So do it at night. essentially, don't believe in everything that you read in the newspapers. If somebody tells you that he solved the energy problem, don't believe him, including me. If I will go there, I will not. So, so don't believe him. And the second one, the last one, if you elect somebody, be careful. Yeah, these are the granting agencies.